ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the guest lecture on Omnibus Law, held by Institution of Law Department, Faculty of Law, Universitas Brawijaya, today, January 28, 2020. It is an honor to me to inform you that among us here, we have Head of Constitutional Law Department, Faculty of Law, Universitas Brawijaya, Dr. Ida Priwurmani. Also, our invited speaker today, Professor Patrick Kaiser from Law School, La Trobe University, Australia, and other lecturers from Faculty of Law, Universitas Brawijaya. Ladies and gentlemen, the agenda of today's guest lecture is discussing omnibus law, especially on its opportunities and challenges on the future of Indonesian legislation. The discussion will start on what is omnibus law really is, then will the omnibus law be a concept in the future that will change the law in Indonesia? Also, what things should be anticipated in the process of forming a bill that is included in the omnibus law category? These are the things that will be discussed and studied in this special lecture today. And therefore, I invite Mr. M. Dahlan and Ms. Aulia Nabila as student moderator to lead our discussion today. Please give them applause.
So, omnibus is originally a Latin word, and it means everything. Everything. And an omnibus law is a law that covers many different topics. Now, you can immediately understand why an omnibus law may be a particularly complicated piece of legislation, because I'm standing in a room with a number of people from the Constitutional Law Department of the University of Brawijaya, and I'm a constitutional lawyer, and I don't pretend that I know anything about contracts, criminal law, or intellectual property, or any of those other areas. Our job is to be specialists in a particular area of law, and you would know, just as well as I know, that it's actually really hard work to be a specialist in one area. And yet, an omnibus law is intended to cover many different areas of law. So you can immediately appreciate why it's very complicated. Exercise to create an omnibus.
Ya, jadi Profesor Patrick di sini hari ini akan menjelaskan tentang omnibus law. Jadi mengapa harus omnibus law, kemudian apa saja kelebihan-kelebihannya, kemudian kekurangannya juga. Dan yang akan kita diskusikan hari ini di sini tidak mendetail tentang apa sih sebenarnya isunya di Omnibus Law yang sedang ada di Indonesia atau yang sedang menjadi kontroversi di Indonesia, tapi lebih kepada semacam hal yang sifatnya lebih teknis atau lebih formal tentang Omnibus Law. Dan di sini Patrick akan membagi pengetahuannya di bidang constitutional law, hukum tata negara, soal hal tersebut. Kemudian Omnibus sendiri adalah sebuah istilah yang berasal dari bahasa Latin yang artinya itu everything atau segalanya gitu. Jadi bisa dipahami bahwa omnibus law di sini adalah sebuah produk hukum yang meng-cover banyak topik sekaligus dalam satu instrumen seperti itu. Kemudian di sini kita sudah bisa mengetahui bahwa omnibus law-nya kan sangat kompleks sifatnya. Jadi sebuah produk hukum yang sifatnya sangat kompleks. Dan karena di sini ada Bapak Ibu dosen-dosen hukum tata negara, beliau bilang bahwa tidak akan merasa sebagai orang yang mengetahui segala hal tentang omnibus law tadi, karena memang untuk bisa fokus di satu area saja di bidang hukum itu sudah membutuhkan kerja keras, sudah sangat sulit. Dan apalagi di sini kita bicara omnibus law yang meng-cover banyak topik sekaligus seperti itu.
Okay, so let's start with the positives. Okay, an omnibus law can be good. An omnibus law can do good things. So sometimes a parliament or a legislature will want to wipe the slate clean and start over. So, for example, what if you live in a country that has had a revolution and it's been a positive thing? Okay? Then you might want to have legislation that starts from scratch and covers a whole range of different topics because you've had that revolution. Another time is when you want to engage in significant reform. So you recognise that there are serious problems in the way that law is operating, and you want to have what people call a paradigm shift. That is, instead of doing it this way, we want to do it this way. You know, so a paradigm shift. And the third circumstance where a legislature will have a really good idea, but they want to simplify the law. So maybe there are many, many, many laws, but they can say the same thing with less words. So there's a famous quote from, I think it was Winston Churchill, it might have been an old coward, where he was writing a letter to a friend, and he started the letter, "If I had more time, I would have written you a shorter letter." Because it takes time sometimes to produce something that's crisp. But those are the three circumstances where an omnibus law can be a really good idea. After a revolution, when there's a paradigm shift, or when you want to engage in radical reform or simplification.
Menurut Prof. Patrick, kelebihan dari omnibus law yang pertama adalah misalnya ketika suatu negara itu ingin memulai sesuatu dari awal, misalnya contohnya dalam konteks terjadi revolusi di negara itu, jadi butuh untuk membuat berhukum legislasi dari awal, jadi mentah seperti itu. Kemudian yang kedua adalah dalam konteks terjadi reformasi atau di sini yang diistilahkan dengan paradigm shift atau perubahan paradigma. Nah, jadi legislasinya sudah ada, tapi ada pemikiran-pemikiran paradigma yang berubah sehingga legislasinya itu perlu diubah. Kemudian yang ketiga adalah untuk menyederhanakan legislasi di negara itu. Jadi tidak ada perubahan yang secara radikal begitu, tapi hanya butuh penyederhanaan dalam kondisi-kondisi tertentu. Kemudian di sini beliau mencontohkan sebuah kutipan dari Winston Churchill yang berbunyi, kalau ada waktu saya tak akan menulis surat yang singkat kepada Anda, karena gitu ya Pak ya. Kalau kadang untuk membuat sesuatu yang tertulis itu memang membutuhkan waktu dan kerja keras yang lumayan besar.
Okay, so let me give you some examples. So the first example, and I'm really going out on a limb here, so you have to tell me if I've got this wrong, but the Pancasila, okay, is an example of omnibus legislation after a revolution, okay? So between, you know, in 1945, when Sukarno and Hatta produced the Pancasila, they were engaged in a revolutionary act, which of course was followed by the Revolutionary War against the Dutch, and the objective was to wipe the slate clean and start with a law, the Constitution, which was authentically Indonesian. But if you look carefully at the Pancasila, you see that it covers a number of different topics. So for example, it talks about belief in the Almighty God. It talks about a just and civilized humanity. It talks about a unified Indonesia. It talks about democracy led by the wisdom in a consensus of representatives. And it talks about social justice for all Indonesians. So they are the five pillars of Indonesian society. But if you think about the topics, they are actually quite different. So really, the Pancasila is an excellent example about a law about everything. And that's what an omnibus law is. It is a law about many different topics. Now, as constitutional lawyers, we would often look at constitutional documents like the Pancasila and think, okay, well, it only really does one thing. But actually, the Pancasila covers many, many different topics. So it's not too far from the idea of an omnibus.
Jadi Prof. Patrick mencontohkan yang pertama di sini Pancasila sebagai sebuah gambaran yang sangat tepat untuk Omnibus Law. Karena yang pertama, Pancasila ini dibuat dalam kondisi-kondisi yang bisa dibilang revolusioner, karena di sini setelah pemerintah kolonial Belanda pergi dari Indonesia, kemudian di sini kita ingin membuat suatu hukum yang sama sekali bukan dari Belanda, tapi benar-benar Indonesia banget seperti itu istilahnya. Dan yang kedua adalah Pancasila ini, meskipun ini adalah satu hal yang dijadikan ideologi Indonesia, tapi sebenarnya meng-cover topik-topik yang berbeda. Karena bisa kita lihat di situ ada lima sila, ada Ketuhanan Yang Maha Esa, manusia yang adil dan beradab, itu dan seterusnya. Itu sebenarnya meng-cover topik yang berbeda-beda. Jadi ini contoh yang sangat tepat untuk Omnibus Law.
Yeah. Okay. So the second example I'm going to give is an Australian example. This is to illustrate the paradigm shift approach. So, in Queensland, which is a state of Australia, in the 1950s, the 1960s, the 1970s, the 1980s, there was a lot of corruption, a lot of very bad police corruption and governmental corruption, and some judicial corruption. So what happened there was there were many different laws in Queensland which created many different crimes, criminal offences, and there were many different penalties which applied to those criminal offences. So the law was very complicated. And in addition to that, the law was enforced by the police in a very corrupt way. So if you were involved in illegal gambling or illegal trade in alcohol, okay? The police would let you keep on doing that activity. They would let you keep on being an illegal alcohol dealer or engaging in illegal gambling as long as you paid them some money, right? And if the matter got to court, you know, if you were fined or what have you, charged with criminal offences and the matter got to court, the police would lie to the judges about what happened. They would prepare statements that were false. And so many innocent people were being affected by police corruption and much illegal activity was still going on because of the police corruption. So the government became very concerned about this. They appointed a judge named Tony Fitzgerald to review all of these criminal laws, and they decided to pass an omnibus law called the Queensland Penalties and Sentences Act. And what the Penalties and Sentences Act did was it took all the power around criminal penalties away from the police and gave it to the judges, independent judges. And then the law changed the principles of sentencing so that the principles were what is fair, what is reasonable, what is proportionate, which, of course, if any of you know about criminal law, you'll know that they are three very important principles in sentencing. So it was because of many decades of corruption that the Queensland government decided they really needed to have one law that covered all sentencing. They needed to start from scratch and throw out many other laws and just have one law to deal with sentencing. So it was a paradigm shift.
Contoh yang kedua ini dari Australia. Jadi pada waktu itu di tahun 50-an ada banyak praktek korupsi di Australia yang dipraktekkan oleh yang itu melibatkan polisi juga. Dan pada waktu itu yang berlaku di Australia adalah ada banyak produk-produk hukum yang berlaku untuk berbagai macam tindak kriminal. Jadi hukum pidana waktu itu sangat kompleks. Dan itu tidak menyelesaikan masalah dan di mana tindakan korupsi ini semakin berdampak kepada orang-orang tidak bersalah itu tadi. Dan akhirnya di sini pemerintah dan lembaga legislatif Australia di Queensland itu mengeluarkan yang disebut dengan Queensland Penalties and Sentences Act itu tadi. Dan itu adalah contoh dari Omnibus Law karena berbagai hukum pidana yang tadinya diri sendiri-sendiri dan kompleks itu dijadikan dalam satu produk hukum dan di situ juga diterapkan berbagai prinsip-prinsip hukum baru, misalnya di situ ada independensi hakim, kemudian prinsip-prinsip pemidanaan dan lain sebagainya.
Saya panggil ya, Pak. Ya, saya baru tahu juga ya bahwa ternyata di Australia di Queensland pada tahun 1950-an sampai 1980 akhir ternyata sama dengan di kita gitu. Banyak sekali tindak penyalahgunaan wewenang terutama yang dilakukan oleh polisi. Jadi di sana illegal gambling itu kan judi-judi yang tidak ada yang ilegal, lalu kemudian prostitusi ilegal dan kemudian jual beli alkohol yang ilegal itu terjadi di mana-mana dan itu pelanggaran hukum. Lalu kemudian polisi itu akan menangkap pelanggar hukum ini, tapi kemudian nanti siapapun yang bisa menyuap polisi, maka polisi nanti dalam kesaksian di pengadilan itu akan mengatakan bahwa ini ternyata buktinya tidak kuat dan lain sebagainya. Jadi sebenarnya sama saja dengan kita. Nah pada saat itu di sana undang-undang tentang tindak pidana kriminalnya itu ternyata ada beberapa untuk judi ada sendiri, untuk prostitusi ada sendiri, untuk mabuk-mabuk apa namanya itu jual beli itu ada sendiri. Dan kemudian yang paling menarik menurut saya, pemerintah Queensland waktu itu negara bagian itu meminta seorang hakim yang bernama Tony Fitzgerald ini untuk melakukan review dari undang-undang kita itu mana sih yang tidak baik sehingga kemudian ini bisa membuat penegak hukum itu bisa melanggar apa namanya bisa menyimpangi isi undang-undang ini. Nah ternyata di sana hakim itu juga dilibatkan untuk melakukan review terhadap satu undang-undang. Maka kemudian direview dan setelah direview itu dibuatlah dikumpulkan semua undang-undang tentang tidak pidana yang banyak itu menjadi satu undang-undang yang di dalamnya berdasar pada prinsip-prinsip yang sangat baik dan membangun sistem yang lebih ketat sehingga kemudian sekarang mungkin masih ada korupsi tapi menjadi sangat sedikit sekali.
And then the final example is when a government has a really good idea. It's a new idea, but it's a really good one. And maybe that one good idea is just going to change a lot of things. And a good example of that, I think, is an Australian piece of legislation, so a national law called the Trade Practices Act. And basically, what happened in Australia was there was much commercial law regulating different aspects of commercial behaviour, good commercial ethical behaviour. But it was law across many different areas, contract law, commercial law, company law, trade law, competition law, many different areas. But there was one unifying principle that needed to be put in legislation. And that unifying principle was that no one should engage in misleading or deceptive conduct in the course of trade. And that's it. It's just one, essentially one principle. No one should engage in misleading or deceptive conduct in the course of trade. Now, such a simple principle, but you can immediately appreciate, if you just think about it for a minute, how many different areas of the law that principle is going to affect. So it is omnibus in its effect, because it had an impact on so many different areas of the law, just because it's one simple, broad-ranging principle.
Kemudian contoh yang ketiga adalah ketika pemerintahan di suatu negara itu memiliki sebuah ide atau pemikiran yang sangat bagus yang itu akan diwujudkan dalam satu perundang-undangan. Dan contohnya di sini di Australia juga adalah Australian Trade Practices Act yang ini mengatur tentang etika-etika dalam kegiatan perdagangan dan ini mengcover banyak hal. Jadi misalnya dalam perdagangan, kemudian perlindungan konsumen dan lain sebagainya. Tapi sebenarnya undang-undang ini menggambarkan satu prinsip hukum yaitu bahwa tidak boleh ada seorang pun dalam kegiatan perdagangan yang melakukan tindakan yang sifatnya menyesatkan atau menipu. Jadi prinsip ini kemudian walaupun hanya satu prinsip memberikan dampak yang besar kepada paradigma atau pemikiran tentang kegiatan perdagangan di Australia.
Okay, so I've gone through some reasons why it's good to have an omnibus approach, why there are sometimes circumstances where it is good to make big reforms across a number of different areas. But omnibus laws can also be problematic, you know, so there can be problems with omnibus laws. The first problem with omnibus laws is that they can often be very difficult to draft. They can be very difficult to prepare an omnibus law. So, those of you who have some understanding of legislative drafting would know that it's a very complicated activity. It normally takes a very long time and it involves knowledge of many different things and also a clear understanding of the history of how legislation is operating. You know, how courts have interpreted legislation and omnibus legislation only compounds that difficulty. It is difficult enough to draft a piece of legislation in one area of the law, but when you compound that by drafting legislation in many areas, that makes it especially difficult. So, for example, in the media, over the last few months, there have been different reports about the omnibus law on job creation that is being planned by the government. So some reports say that there will be more than 70 laws changed. Other reports say 75 laws will change. Some reports say that 82 laws will change, and some say that 85 laws will change. So that's a lot, and the numbers seem to be expanding. Okay, so that could be a good thing, but it does reinforce this point. It is a very difficult task. It's very difficult to draft effective omnibus laws.
Kekurangan yang pertama dari omnibus law itu adalah dalam hal bagaimana sulitnya merancang dari omnibus law itu. Dan di sini yang memahami legislative drafting akan tahu bagaimana kompleksnya merancang satu bahkan hanya satu produk hukum yang mengcover satu area saja. Belum lagi omnibus law ini mengcover berbagai area. Dan misalnya di sini Prof. Patrick memberikan contoh di berita di media itu ada pemberitaan-pemberitaan yang berbeda mengenai omnibus law. Ada artikel yang bilang bahwa omnibus law ini akan mengubah 74 undang-undang, ada yang bilang 75, ada yang bilang 80 sekian. Nah, dan jumlahnya itu sepertinya makin banyak seperti itu. Jadi itulah itu adalah gambaran bagaimana kompleksnya drafting
or also. Okay, so the second challenge with omnibus laws is that, the second problem is because the parliament or the legislature is being expected to pass a piece of legislation that covers many different topics, that necessarily limits the amount of scrutiny of each of those issues, because we know how parliaments and legislatures work. There are many, many people. They are there to represent millions of people, and they have a lot of concerns about what the legislation should include and what it should not include. And that is why they have debates in the legislature. So the idea, of course, is that these people are representing the interests of the public, but if they're being expected to consider many, many different topics, that makes their job more difficult. It means the debates that they have within the parliament are going to be more complicated, and it means their capacity to scrutinise each provision of the legislation and think of how it impacts 70, 75, 80 or 85 other pieces of legislation is actually a very, very complicated task to do.
Jadi yang menarik Bapak sekalian, karena barangkali ada di antara kita itu yang menjadi peneliti dari ilmu perundang-undangan dan perancangan peraturan perundang-undangan adalah bahwa persoalan terbesar dari omnibus law, dan kalau kita tarik dalam konteks Indonesia, adalah tantangannya adalah bahwa omnibus law itu kemudian menciptakan satu keadaan di mana kesempatan untuk mendebat, kesempatan untuk membahas rancangan undang-undang omnibus law itu menjadi sangat terbatas sekali seperti itu. Karena apa? Karena ini kan misalkan dikatakan oleh Prof. Patrick tadi ada beberapa berita itu yang simpang siur. Omnibus law kita tentang cipta lapangan kerja itu, cipta karya itu informasinya mengubah 70 undang-undang aturan. Ada yang mengatakan mengubah 80, bahkan katanya mengubah 85. Nah, bisa kita bayangkan kalau misalkan banyak sekali aturan itu yang kemudian dimix, dijadikan satu, jadi satu rancangan undang-undang, itu kan sistemnya pertama prosesnya itu panjang sekali sistemnya itu, dikatakan kompetitif. Tapi kenyataannya kan tidak. Beberapa bulan ini katanya sudah jadi rancangan. pertanyaannya, kalau di dalam pembentukan peraturan undang-undangan itu ada persiapan, setelah persiapan itu penyusunan, itu menyusun naskah akademik dan menyusun rancangan undang-undangnya. Lah kalau cepat seperti ini, itu naskah akademiknya seperti apa? Apakah itu kemudian merepresentasikan kepentingan dari setiap kelompok? Kami jadi sangat dipertanyakan, bahkan kita sekarang para guru menolak katanya seperti itu, karena ada beberapa isu besar, ya kan? Apa namanya itu upah minimum dihapus, kemudian ini dihapus dan lain sebagainya. Itu dikatakan oleh Prof. Patrick. Jadi kesempatan untuk mendebat isi rancangannya itu jadi sangat terbatas sekali. Itu persoalannya. Maka besar kemungkinan nanti kalau tidak disusun dengan sangat hati-hati dengan waktu yang sangat lama dan kemudian mengakomodasi kepentingan dari banyak pihak, sangat besar kemungkinan isi dari Omnibus Law ini nanti akan merugikan kepentingan banyak pihak, sehingga judicial review akan sangat mungkin terjadi. Yang berikutnya adalah keterbatasan screening itu pengawasan terhadap proses pembentukannya. Seperti itu. Mau lirik itu wong banyak sekali seperti itu kan, mau lihatnya itu menjadi sangat sulit, apalagi kalau dikebut seperti ini. Itu persoalannya.
The third issue with omnibus laws, or the third challenge to address, is it can make consultation very difficult just because of the complexity of the legislation. It means that you have to consult many, many more civil society groups, government departments, non-government organisations, key stakeholders in society. The more issues you try to address in legislation, the more complicated your consultation task becomes.
Kemudian kekurangan yang ketiga dari Omnibus Law ini adalah proses konsultasinya dalam pembentukannya itu menjadi sulit karena semakin banyak topik yang akan di-cover dalam sebuah produk hukum itu tentu akan makin banyak juga pihak yang harus dikonsultasikan dan makin banyak juga pemangku kepentingan yang dikonsultasikan. Misalnya ada makin banyak NGO atau masyarakat sipil yang harus diajak terlibat dan seterusnya.
And the final two points are interrelated, fourth and fifth point. They are that because it's more complicated than omnibus law, it can be hard to implement and it can add to the complexity rather than the law. So you would all be familiar with the fact that sometimes legislatures will add layer and layer and layer and layer of laws. And sometimes how those laws interrelate is a very complicated thing. Some would say that's a good thing for lawyers because it gives us something to do. On the other hand, many people in civil society, including people in business, would say that they want that simplification. The difficulty is sometimes when you try to simplify something, you actually end up making it more complicated. So it's a process that needs to be engaged in very carefully.
Kemudian poin yang keempat dan kelima dari kekurangan Omnibus Law itu adalah yang keempat penerapannya akan menjadi semakin sulit dan yang kelima akan semakin menambah kompleksitas atau kerumitan dari sistem hukum itu sendiri. Karena kita juga tahu bahwa keterkaitan antara satu produk hukum dengan yang lainnya itu juga akan sangat kompleks. Nah, ini mungkin ada yang menganggap ini hal yang baik, terutama bagi lawyer karena akan menambah pekerjaan bagi mereka. Tapi banyak juga pihak-pihak yang lebih ingin hal itu menjadi sederhana.
Okay, so we know that the government is planning two omnibus laws. One of them is concerned with draft law on job creation, and the other is the draft law on taxation. And at the moment, there is no public exposure draft available on the draft law on job creation, so any comments that I would make on it are entirely speculative. We know that there are different reports on the number of laws that might be affected, 70, 79, maybe 2005. Some people have estimated that there may be over 1,000 articles affected by the revision. The President has provided a very significant justification for the reform, and that is these articles slow us down, responding to changes in the world. If our laws are rigid, we would not be able to respond to changes. We are hampered by the laws made on our own. So the President is signalling, I think, a paradigm shift. So it's not a revolution, but it's a paradigm shift. The idea is we have a commercial regime, a bunch of business laws doing different things. What we want to do is move to a new paradigm. That seems to me to be what the President is advising.
Jadi di sini di Indonesia sekarang sedang didiskusikan mengenai dua rancangan undang-undang yang katanya akan menjadi Omnibus Law. Jadi yang pertama adalah rancangan undang-undang Cipta Lapangan Kerja dan yang kedua adalah RUU Perpajakan. Dan ini cukup spekulatif terkait dengan jumlah undang-undang dan pasal-pasal yang kabarnya akan berubah seperti itu karena dua Omnibus Law ini. Dan ini adalah poin di mana Presiden Jokowi itu meng-highlight, menggarisbawahi perubahan. Jadi menginginkan perubahan. Jadi bahwa di dunia ini perubahan terjadi dengan sangat cepat dan bahwa kita tidak bisa terus-menerus bergantung pada hukum yang sifatnya kaku dan tidak responsif terhadap perubahan begitu. Jadi di sini kalau menurut Prof. Patrick, sepertinya Omnibus Law di Indonesia, diskusi Omnibus Law di Indonesia ini lebih mengarah pada tipe yang kedua tadi. Jadi mengenai paradigm shift atau perubahan paradigma yang seperti tadi sudah dijelaskan di
So I understand that there's a legislative body in the House of Representatives that's set up a working committee, and they've been given the job of analysing the legislation which will be considered as part of this reform process, and the coordinating economic minister, Mr. Alanga Atato, has said that the Omnibus bill on bills on job creation and taxation would be put before the national legislative program list before being deliberated in the House of Representatives. So there's a clear process to what is going on, and it's following what I understand is the traditional and time-honored legislative process. But it's happening in a very short time frame. So. The first time the idea of an omnibus law was mentioned was in October 20th, and then the President and the Coordinating Economic Minister made a number of speeches in November and December, providing a bit more detail about the topics that would be covered in the law, and now there's a group of people the House of Representatives who are doing some important work, and there are also some other groups of people who are working on it, which I'll get to.
Ini terkait dengan dua rancangan undang-undang ini, semuanya prosesnya ini bisa dibilang relatif sangat singkat, karena total hanya ada beberapa bulan saja sebelum undang-undang ini menjadi agenda pembahasan di DPR. Padahal di sini Menko Perekonomian itu mengatakan bahwa rancangan undang-undang ini semestinya harus masuk di prolegnas dulu seperti itu. Nah, jadi ini prosesnya terjadi dalam waktu yang cukup singkat.
So the rationale So it's useful to take a few steps back and ask what's the reason behind the legislation? You know, what motivated the government to think about changing things? And there is a bit of writing, a bit of research that's been done by different scholars, and also mainly by the major accounting firms like PricewaterhouseCoopers and some of the larger commercial law firms in Jakarta, and they've been trying to work out what the rationale for it was. And there is a broad consensus that the government was concerned about Indonesia's ranking in the World Bank's 2020 list of ease of doing business index. And there was some concerns about the fact that at the moment Indonesia is 73rd on that index. But so, for example, Singapore is second, Malaysia is 15th, and Thailand is 27th. So there's some concerns about perhaps Indonesia falling a bit behind. But if I could just go down to the next slide just for a moment. In my opinion, Indonesia does not need to be too anxious about its progress, because in fact, in the last 3 years, Indonesia has gone up 42 places in the list of countries around the world in terms of ease of doing business. So really, the economic transformation of Indonesia and the regulatory transformation of Indonesia over the last 3 years has been very impressive. Very impressive indeed. And Indonesia is well ahead of other countries in the region, like the Philippines. So I think it's important when you're reading research about the rationale for these reforms that you understand that it's within a context where the regulatory progress of Indonesia has really been very, very remarkable indeed. So if we can go back to the previous slide. So I might make that point and then I'll keep going.
Jadi ini berbicara mengenai kondisi perekonomian di Indonesia yang kemudian menjadi relevan apabila dikaitkan dengan RUU Omnibus Law itu. Jadi kalau menurut rankingnya World Bank dalam hal kemudahan berbisnis di Indonesia, itu Indonesia itu berada di ranking 73. Dan kemudian di bawahnya itu ada faktor-faktor yang kemudian mempengaruhi perolehan ranking tersebut. Dan kemudian terkait dengan ranking yang didapatkan ini, Indonesia dalam waktu 3 tahun terakhir itu sudah melompat 42 ranking sebenarnya. Dan itu hanya dalam waktu 3 tahun saja. Dan ini menurut Prof. Patrick menggambarkan pertumbuhan yang sangat signifikan yang dialami oleh Indonesia, dan ini juga sangat baik apabila dibandingkan dengan negara-negara lain di region, di wilayah Asia Tenggara seperti itu.
Jadi dalam konteks Omnibus Law itu sendiri, Bapak Uskandar, menurut Prof. Patrick, sebenarnya pemerintah atau kita semua semestinya itu membaca hasil penelitian terlebih dahulu, dan kita sudah memahami bahwa sebenarnya dalam 3 tahun terakhir kemudahan di dalam berbisnis itu kita sudah memperbaiki banyak hal, sehingga kita melompati 42 posisi seperti itu. Sederhananya, sebenarnya apa yang sudah kita lakukan itu sudah baik dalam 3 tahun terakhir. Maka kemudian kita bisa bertanya, apakah memang Omnibus Law dalam bidang dua hal itu tadi, apakah memang betul-betul diperlukan seperti itu? Semestinya itu didasarkan pada riset ilmiah yang sama. Jangan sampai nanti kemudian, ya, dan mungkin saja kalau ada orang yang berpikir apakah ada agenda di balik itu, karena dibuat dengan terlalu cepat, padahal semestinya itu melalui proses yang sangat panjang. Kalau mau jadi sangat bagus, konsultasi dengan banyak pihak, jangan sampai ada dirugikan. Lalu kemudian tidak apa, kalau ingin mudah itu jangan sampai nanti menambah rugi dan lain sebagainya. So, poinnya itu di sana harus sangat ilmiah melihat kondisi.
So the, if it, yeah, just go back.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. So the ease of doing business score, just for the sake of completeness, is made up of a number of different things. For example, when it comes to obtaining a business license, Indonesia is actually right up the top of the score in the ease of doing business. So it ranks 81%. When it comes to enforcing contracts, it's down to 45%. So you have to look at when the World Bank says, okay, Indonesia's at 73, they're taking lots of different information into account. There are some areas where Indonesia is performing incredibly well. There are other areas where a bit more work is needed. And I think part of the reason behind the omnibus legislation is to address those issues. If we can now go down to... the President gave a speech in December, and he's identified 11 regulatory topics that are going to be covered in the omnibus legislation. So we can see from the range of topics this is a very, very large reform. This is a significant paradigm shift. And one of the things that would interest us in particular as academics is bullet point 6, which is research and innovation funding. So I think we can expect that there will be further reforms of how we go about our business in the universities. And it will be very interesting to see what those reforms will look like, because obviously we have to process them into how we do our work in the tertiary education sector. But as you can see, this is really big. You know, we're covering a lot of different topics, and so it'll be fascinating to see the exposure draft when it's released to the public, just so we can get a sense of the scale of the performance as well.
Jadi slide sebelumnya mengenai rating itu menunjukkan bahwa ada banyak faktor dalam hal menentukan rating kemudahan bisnis tadi. Dan di sini misalnya dalam hal izin untuk melakukan usaha, Indonesia itu berada di rating atas. Tapi dalam hal pelaksanaan kontrak, Indonesia itu berada di rating bawah. Dan ini menunjukkan banyak faktor yang mempengaruhi hal kemudahan bisnis itu tadi, dan itu mungkin yang menjadi pertimbangan, salah satu hal yang menjadi pertimbangan pemerintah mengapa ini membuat Omnibus Law. Dan selain itu, di slide ini ada diskusi yang ada di forum legislatif Vimus Renbangmas, dan bahwa Omnibus Law itu akan mengcover 11 aspek. Dan yang mungkin menarik bagi kita sebagai sivitas akademika itu adalah poin ke-6, jadi tentang pembiayaan riset dan inovasi. Dan ini di sini kita bisa lihat cukup luas dan beragam topik yang akan di-cover dalam Omnibus Law ini tadi.
Okay. So we also know from reports, public reports, that the Omnibus Law Task Force is being chaired by the chairman of the Indonesian Chamber of Commerce and Industry, and the significance of that, of course, is that it's very clear that the government wants to have a business focus, because they have tasked a business leader with the role of supervising the legislative development process. And Mr. Goswami said that it was reported in late November that they were starting work on it then. So, you know, this is only, about 7 or 8 weeks ago, 9 weeks ago. So, you know, it's a very fast process that they're engaged in. And throughout December, there's been a number of internal discussions about the legislation. We can only guess that there's been progress in the development of the legislation. And again, it's been publicly advised that drafts would be available in early January. They're not available yet, but you could hardly complain about that given the volume of the undertaking that's ongoing.
Jadi di sini nampak bahwa pemerintah itu terlihat sangat ingin terus memperbaiki kondisi bisnis di Indonesia. Jadi misalnya di sini dibentuk satuan tugas task force yang diketahui oleh Pak Ruslani ini, dan kemudian dan itu hanya dikerjakan dalam waktu beberapa minggu gitu. Dan di sini kemudian di bulan Januari rencananya akan diterbitkan RUU-nya itu. Sekarang belum ada, tetapi mungkin dalam waktu dekat ini kita bisa expect itu akan dikeluarkan oleh pemerintah.
Iya, sekali lagi Bapak sekalian, dalam proses pembentukan peraturan perundangan kita tahu bahwa ada 5 tahapan. Nah, mulai dari tahap persiapan yang semestinya masuk di program legislasi nasional terlebih dahulu 1 tahun sebelumnya semestinya, lalu kemudian nanti di tahun berikutnya itu dimulai melakukan research, nanti ada academic paper yang semestinya itu menjadi sangat panjang sekali karena topiknya yang dibahas itu sangat banyak sekali. Ini tadi karena topiknya banyak sekali, maka semestinya prosesnya itu sangat panjang sekali. Dan kemudian betul yang dikatakan Prof. Patrick, di dalam proses research itu semestinya kemudian ada apa namanya itu tanya jawab, kemudian ada FGD dan lain sebagainya yang menghadirkan semua stakeholder, jadi para pemangku kepentingan itu, dan kemudian mereka diberikan kesempatan untuk bersuara, untuk memberikan aspirasi dan lain sebagainya. Maka kemudian ya, yang dikatakan oleh dia tadi kalau bahasa kita itu ya Tuhan gitu, ini hanya beberapa minggu kemudian ternyata RUU-nya itu sudah jadi dan informasinya selama ini sudah mau dibahas. Jadi masuk dalam pansus, nanti tentu pansus di DPR kemudian dibahas, dan kemudian pembahasannya kan 2 kali. Nanti dibahas di pansus, pembahasan tingkat 1 langsung naik ke tingkat 2, itu nanti diparipurnakan. Dan besar kemungkinan nanti ini akan diterima di paripurna seperti itu. Makanya kemudian setelah itu langsung ditandatangani oleh presiden, disahkan karena ini undang-undang dan jadi undang-undang. Ini kan sesuatu yang menjadi pertanyaan besar seperti itu. Kalau kita memang mau kalau tadi dikatakan kita dibelenggu oleh peraturan undang-undang kita sendiri, kita ingin lepas dari belenggu itu. Pertanyaannya, apakah lepas dari belenggu itu dibuat apa melalui proses yang sangat cepat kan tidak? Kita harus memastikan bahwa ini untuk kepentingan rakyat, bukan untuk kepentingan siapa pun.
Baik,
terima kasih
Pak Ruslani. Okay, so PricewaterhouseCoopers have done an analysis of the Omnibus tax law, and I've reviewed. There is a draft available of that legislation release. There was a Ministry of Finance press release from late last year, which indicated that there are going to be reductions in the corporate income tax rate, tax exemptions on dividends received by domestic taxpayers, tax reductions on interest income received by foreign taxpayers, revisions to the territorial basis in calculating taxable income, and also relaxation on creditable inputs for value-added tax. So if you're a tax lawyer, if you're interested in taxation, the Omnibus tax law is changing a lot of different taxes. Having said that, it's not really changing the tax system. So I know it's been labelled as an Omnibus tax law, perhaps because it's changing many different forms of taxation, but it's only really lowering rates of taxation. So it's not actually a major reform, in my personal opinion. You know, taxes go up, they go down. The thrust of this Omnibus tax law is to lower taxation in a number of different areas. The idea behind that is to encourage foreign investment in particular. The economic theory behind that is if you encourage foreign investment, then the economy will grow, and that means even though you've reduced tax rates, your revenue collection will increase because your economy is growing. Indonesia has been growing at 5% a year for a number of years. Obviously the government wants it to be 6, 7, 8, 9%. So there's an economic theory that underpins the tax law changes. I don't see the tax law as a paradigm shift because historically rates of tax have lowered and have risen depending upon what the government is trying to achieve. You might lower taxes to get more foreign investment, you might raise taxes if you want more revenue for social services or what have you. And of course you can do both at any given time if your economy is growing.
Jadi ini adalah info yang didapat dari press release Kementerian Keuangan. Jadi tampak di sini bahwa RUU Omnibus Law Perpajakan itu akan mengubah berbagai aspek dalam hukum perpajakan di Indonesia. Dan di sini cita-citanya tujuannya adalah untuk memudahkan pembayaran pajak, istilahnya juga merelakskan membuat pengaturan mengenai pajak itu jadi lebih fleksibel sehingga akan meningkatkan investasi asing di Indonesia. Dan di sini didasarkan pada teori ekonomi yang mengatakan bahwa semakin banyak investasi asing yang masuk di Indonesia, maka pertumbuhan ekonomi akan meningkat. Dan kemudian meski pajaknya itu turun, pendapatan yang didapat dari pajak itu akan turun, tetap saja pendapatan kita akan meningkat karena pertumbuhan ekonomi kita sendiri sudah meningkat seperti itu.
Okay, so I've mentioned the changes to tax. I'll just give you some quick examples. So you can see the reduction in corporate income tax rate from 25% to 22%. 2021 and then down to 20% starting 2022. So that's just an example of the reforms. I won't go through in detail because you will have access to my slides, but you can see the trend is for tax to be reduced over time. The idea is that that will create incentives for business, in particular small and medium-sized enterprises. So we know that when President Jokowi delivered his inauguration speech, he said that it was an important part of the economic reform program that he took to the public in the election, that he would be providing more incentives for small business and medium-sized business, and reduction of the corporate income tax rate is consistent with that.
Dan kemudian ini adalah contoh dari apa yang kira-kira akan diubah dalam RUU Omnibus tentang perpajakan. Jadi yang pertama adalah diturunkannya pajak penghasilan. Kemudian yang kedua adalah tax exemption, jadi pembebasan pajak dalam hal dividen yang diterima oleh pekerja informal seperti itu. Dan ini juga kita bisa mengingat bagaimana Presiden Jokowi menyampaikan dalam pidato kemenangannya bahwa akan akan terus memudahkan investasi dan kegiatan usaha di Indonesia, dan itu akan ditujukan pada pertumbuhan ekonomi.
So, just some concluding thoughts. There's two omnibus laws that are being considered at the moment. One of them is the tax law. In my opinion, it is, while it covers many different forms of taxation, and therefore can be called an omnibus law, it is not a major reform. It is fairly minor adjustments of tax rates over the next 5 years. But the law on job creation is a significant reform. because it's covering so many different areas of the economy. So it will be very interesting to see what that law looks like when the draft is made public. There's been a lot of speculation about how it would impact on regulation of land use, how it would impact on mining, how it would impact on the environment, and they are all very important questions. And as information about the legislation becomes more clear, I'm sure that many civil society organisations will be seeking the opportunity to consult with the government to offer their opinions, and it'll be interesting to see what happens next.
Jadi kesimpulan yang diberikan oleh Prof. Patrick bahwa di sini sudah ada dua RUU Omnibus Law yang diajukan oleh pemerintah. Jadi yang pertama untuk RUU perpajakan sendiri, menurut beliau ini tidak akan memberikan perubahan yang major atau sangat signifikan, meskipun area yang di cover itu banyak. Tapi untuk RUU Cipta Lapangan Kerja inilah yang akan menimbulkan perubahan signifikan, dan diantaranya ini juga akan memberikan dampak pada kegiatan pertambangan, kemudian pada masalah lingkungan, karena di sini ada wacana akan mengubah mekanisme AMDAL menjadi mekanisme yang lainnya seperti itu. Dan karena itu akan menarik nanti bagaimana wujud dari RUU Cipta Lapangan Kerja ini apabila nanti sudah dikeluarkan. Dan akan menarik juga untuk melihat bagaimana kalangan masyarakat sipil itu akan berupaya untuk terus mengkonsul, berkonsultasi dengan pemerintah mengenai penting dari yang dampak yang diberikan oleh RUU Cipta Lapangan Kerja ini.
Bapak-Ibu sekalian, itu tadi penjelasan dari Profesor Patrick Geser tentang pertama barangkali dari aspek teori gitu, dan konsep apa sih Omnibus Law itu. Lalu kemudian tadi dikatakan Omnibus Law itu bisa bagus kalau itu ternyata memang ditujukan karena revolusi misalkan. Makanya tadi yang dicontohkan itu adalah Pancasila, walaupun saya sangat yakin Bapak-Ibu akan berpikir apakah Pancasila itu memang satu norma hukum konkret seperti itu. Ya, itu nanti kita bisa diskusi yang lain, karena beliau kan memang tidak asli dari Indonesia. Ya, tapi Pancasila tetap fundamental norm, gitu, norma-norma dasar. Nah, dikatakan bahwa Pancasila itu ya berisi sesuatu yang sangat luas sekali seperti itu kan, soal kepercayaan terhadap Tuhan, kemudian tata kehidupan yang harus adil, beradab, lalu kemudian Indonesia, persatuan Indonesia, dan lain sebagainya. Nah itu kalau ditujukan untuk revolusi, maka Omnibus Law itu memang akan sangat cocok. Kemudian kedua, kalau misalkan ada perubahan paradigma dalam beberapa hal itu, jadi rezimnya baru lalu kemudian punya paradigmanya berubah, itu biasanya memang dengan Omnibus Law seperti itu semestinya berubah ke yang lebih baik. Yang ketiga biasanya itu simplifikasi, jadi apa namanya itu penyederhanaan terhadap banyak hal. Tapi ini juga menimbulkan persoalan-persoalannya yang tadi itu sudah disampaikan. Nah, Bapak-Ibu sekalian, silakan, kita masih punya waktu sekitar 40 menit untuk berdiskusi. Nah, terima kasih Profesor Sunari Ningsih. Lalu kemudian siapa lagi? Silakan, saya list dulu ya Prof. Profesor Sunari Ningsih. Lalu kemudian silakan yang lain, apapun saudara sekalian, pertanyaan, komentar, atau apapun itu. Ya, siapa namanya Mas? Jafran. Oke, Jafran. Barangkali ada satu lagi dari Bapak sekalian. Nah, Ibu Indah Kurbani. Sementara kita tiga dulu, dan nanti silakan Bu Kuasa Indonesia juga silakan nanti Bu Aulia Nabila akan mentranslate-nya, dan kemudian akan dijawab oleh Prof. Patrick, dan jika masih ada waktu nanti akan saya buka kesempatan pada sesi yang berikutnya. Mas, minta tolong dari Profesor Sari Ningsih terlebih dahulu.
No. Bapak-Ibu sekalian, saya berbahagia sekali bisa menghadiri acara kuliah tamu mengenai Omnibus Law ini. Nah, saya mencoba untuk memahami karena ini sesuatu yang baru buat saya juga. Saya memilih keinginan Pak Jokowi adalah penyederhanaan. Nah, ketika kita memilih untuk menyederhanakan aturan, harapannya ya tidak sulit untuk dilaksanakan. Itu. Jadi jangan kita berandai-andai atau memilih barangkali, oh ini pada masa revolusi, kita sudah tidak revolusi. Kemudian yang kedua tadi Pak Dr. Dahlan mengatakan memang ada perubahan paradigma. Barangkali perubahan paradigma ya, tetapi saya lebih memilih ke penyederhanaan yang diinginkan oleh pemerintah Indonesia. Nah, pertanyaan saya, Prof, sistem ketatanegaraan kita dan sistem perundang-undangan kita ini adalah, kalau masih seperti yang saya pahami, ini civil law. Ya. Nah, apakah sesuai ketika Omnibus Law dirancang pada era kita masih menganut sistem itu dari aspek akademiknya, itu satu. Yang kedua, ketika ini untuk kepentingan pembangunan ekonomi supaya bisnisnya larinya kenceng, supaya Indonesia cepat makmur, rakyatnya tetap cepat sejahtera, bagaimana mengkombin sistem ketatanegaraan kita dengan hadirnya Omnibus Law supaya tidak ada keraguan-keraguan. Selama ini masyarakat ragu, kalangan akademisi ragu. Ini maunya apa? Mau lompat-lompat? Mau apa? Hadirnya Omnibus Law dibuat terlalu singkat, cepat. Ini apa? Siapa sebetulnya yang bertanggung jawab atas percepatan yang tidak manusiawi barangkali, yang biasanya membuat undang-undang lama waktunya di Indonesia ini. Ya. Saya tidak tahu di luar sana. Nah ini bagaimana Pak? Ketika ini dimunculkan kepentingannya untuk supaya ada peningkatan ekonomi rakyat sejahtera, sedangkan sistem kita adalah civil law yang apakah ini bisa disisipkan di sistem itu? Terima kasih Prof. Mohon maaf.
Langsung dijawab dulu biasanya beliau kalau apa ini biasanya nggak lupa ya.
Your question, Professor, I appreciate it. So there's a few parts of the question. The first is this isn't the Omnibus Law isn't just a big change for Indonesian commercial law practice. it's a different approach to legislation, because as we know, in the civil law system, the legislature develops a new law, that law has to be integrated with the other laws in the system. So when you're thinking about the way the legislation fits in with other laws, you don't assume that those other laws are automatically repealed. Whereas in a common law system, once you have omnibus legislation, everything that happened before is gone. So the presumption is that all previous laws in that area have been repealed. So everybody has to start from scratch. And that's, I understand that's at a deep philosophical level. That's something that civil lawyers are not used to. But can I just make this observation? About 25 years ago, in 1995, Indonesia joined the World Trade Organization and signed a treaty called TRIPS, or Trade-Related Aspects of Intellectual Property Rights. And I remember I visited Indonesia a lot in the late 1990s. I was teaching at UI and also at Langa, teaching intellectual property law in those law schools. And there was a lot of anxiety and concern about this entire suite of intellectual property law, so trademarks, copyright, patents. And the old Dutch system had those laws, but they weren't very advanced. You know, they were very dated. So when the new intellectual property laws came in to comply with Indonesia's international obligations, there was a lot of concern about that. And I think, but they were implemented. And even though it has taken time for intellectual property principles to be embedded in the legal culture of Indonesia, it's taken, you know, a number of years for that to happen. Now it works, you know. So, you know, we have the trademark office, we have the patent office, and all of the economic benefits of that flow from that have come. You know, so I remember 25 years ago, people said, "Oh, Indonesia will never have a manufacturing economy." Well, here we are 25 years later, and Indonesia has a manufacturing economy. You know, it can still grow more, but it will grow because the commercial law underpinning the intellectual property law is part of the system. So I think sometimes when we think about legislative reform, we get a bit anxious because we think, okay, well, everything is going to change. But it takes time for society to catch up with it. Just because you pass a law doesn't mean it's going to affect things people. So that's the first point I make. And the second point I make, and I think, Professor, this is a really good part of your question, and it's a really good question to ask. Is there a concern that people in Indonesia will feel some fear because of the volume of change that is coming with this law? And I think that that's a very legitimate concern, especially because we don't have access to a draft of the legislation. And that's why I said at the end of my talk, I think it's going to be very interesting to see what happens once the public has been given a draft. Because I think then there will be a lot of political discourse, and there will be a lot of questions asked, because Indonesia is a democracy. You know, it's quite an extraordinary democracy, really. I remember when I used to come here 25 years ago, when democracy was just starting, really. There were a lot of people saying, will democracy flourish in Indonesia? And you look at the last 25 years, and yes, democracy has flourished in Indonesia. And it's amazing, you know, 25 years ago, the idea that people would have a public demonstration, for example, was just crazy. No one would have done that 30 years ago. But now, today, it happens all the time. So I think that
my impression is that people in Indonesia, you know, they're very engaged in what the government's doing. They're very interested in finding out more. They read the newspapers. They're hungry for information. And so I feel confident that once the draft is released, there will be a lot of discussion. But yes, I think you're quite right, Professor, to identify that as an issue, because when you have paradigm shifts like this, you know, people do feel fear about that sort of thing.
Yeah,
poin yang digarisbawahi oleh Prof. Patrick di sini adalah bahwa akan selalu butuh waktu bagi sebuah produk hukum, apalagi di sini produk hukum yang baru dan dengan paradigma yang baru, untuk benar-benar bisa menjadi bagian secara menyeluruh di dalam sistem hukum di suatu negara seperti itu. Apalagi tadi juga disinggung mengenai masalah civil law dan common law. Jadi kalau di dalam sistem hukum civil law itu, apabila ada suatu produk perundang-undangan, itu tidak secara otomatis mengubah produk hukum yang lain. Dan kalau di common law itu berbeda, karena apabila sudah ada produk hukum yang baru, semua produk hukum yang membicarakan hal yang sama sebelumnya itu akan dicabut, tidak berlaku lagi seperti itu. Dan kemudian yang dicontohkan oleh Prof. Patrick mengenai dibutuhkannya waktu bagi suatu produk hukum untuk bisa benar-benar menjadi bagian dari sistem hukum itu adalah ketika beliau 25 tahun yang lalu mengunjungi Indonesia untuk memberikan kuliah mengenai hakim seperti itu. Dan di situ ada banyak kekhawatiran apakah bisa Indonesia ini memiliki dan menerapkan hakim. Tapi kita lihat sekarang bahwa hakim sudah berlaku, sudah menjadi bagian dari sistem hukum Indonesia, dan orang Indonesia sudah familiar, sangat familiar dengan hakim seperti itu. Adalah
ya, terima kasih Prof. Pertanyaan Prof mengantar pada satu tema nanti untuk diteliti, baik deskripsi maupun tesis dan disertasi. Yang menarik memang seperti ini, Prof Patrick tadi nanya, dia bilang gini, apakah kalau di civil law, apakah kalau di dalam hukum itu ada aturan baru yang dibuat, maka kemudian itu akan menyapu bersih gitu. Apakah itu akan menggantikan peraturan lama? Kan di dalam Undang-Undang 12 tahun 2011 jawabannya yes, jawabannya iya. Tapi persoalannya sekarang seperti ini. Misalkan ada satu omnibus law yang dia hadir dan katanya informasinya itu menggantikan misalkan 70 sampai 85 peraturan yang lain. Pertanyaannya, apakah yang digantikan itu maksudnya itu undang-undang? Ini kan omnibus law ini kan undang-undang gitu ya. Nah, kalau misalkan yang digantikan undang-undang, muncul pertanyaan berikut, apakah 85 undang-undang itu akan diganti secara keseluruhan atau tidak isinya? Kalau ternyata yang direvisi oleh omnibus law ini di dalam 85 undang-undang itu hanya sebagian, ini kan kacau. Maksudnya kacaunya seperti ini. Maka omnibus law yang dibuat ini akan menjadi undang-undang perubahan terhadap banyak sekali undang-undang. Berarti nanti satu undang-undang omnibus law ini akan nempel kepada banyak sekali undang-undang karena dia adalah perubahan. Apakah omnibus law yang hadir ini nanti di dalam ketentuan penutupnya itu kemudian menyatakan bahwa mencabut banyak sekali undang-undang dinyatakan dicabut dan tidak berlaku lagi. Apakah seperti itu? Itu kan makanya betul yang dikatakan Profesor Patrick tadi, kita patut menunggu draftnya itu nanti setelah dibahas di dua tingkat pembahasan lalu kemudian disahkan dan diundangkan. Kita lihat nanti isinya seperti apa. Apakah dia memang betul-betul sama dengan informasi yang ada di media massa bahwa dia menggantikan 85 peraturan. Apakah 85 peraturan yang dimaksud itu adalah undang-undang atau act satu level? Berarti kalau satu level berlaku lex posteriori diarahkan lagi teori. Berarti sudah yang dulu itu satu bersih seperti itu tidak berlaku. Nah kalau seperti itu saya kira itu kok muncul persoalan. Ataukah ini hanya menggantikan beberapa pasal di dalam 85 undang-undang? Nah berarti kan ini undang-undang perubahan seperti itu. Dia nempel di dalam 85 kacau. Makanya kemudian
satu kesimpulan untuk memuluskan rencana Omnibus Law, pasti Undang-Undang Nomor 12 tahun 2011 itu diubah nanti. Yakinlah. Makanya kita semuanya bingung gitu. Kalau niatannya baik, ini untuk simplification, untuk mempermudah banyak prosedur, lalu kemudian Pak Sifardai untuk mengubah paradigma, kenapa tidak dilakukan dengan sangat hati-hati sekali, dilakukan dalam waktu yang sangat panjang. Wong kalau bahan perancangan tapi kita juga belum selesai dan gitu ya. Apalagi dikatakan oleh Prof. Patrick, sebenarnya pertumbuhan ekonomi kita sudah sangat bagus kok, seperti itu gitu, dibandingkan dengan beberapa negara lain. Betul Prof. Makanya kemudian patut kita tunggu, dan nanti kalau sudah keluar itu pasti banyak komentar dan mungkin sudah akan disambut dengan judicial review, terutama dari kelompok buruh, pasti nanti judicial review ke Mahkamah Konstitusi, Constitutional Court, dan lain sebagainya. Terima kasih Prof.
Just one additional comment for you, Professor. I understand that you indicated that simplification would have been preferable to a paradigm shift, and I can understand why you would say that. I sometimes think that it's important to keep in view that Indonesia is it's a very complicated country. That's one of the things that makes it a wonderful place to visit and a very interesting place. But when you look at the ease of doing business list and you see that Singapore is second, you should never forget that Singapore is one island. It is, ethnically, it is very simple. It has essentially one or two languages. It's very easy to regulate because there's only a few million people. Whereas Indonesia has 1,000 islands, of course, one national language, but still many, many people speak traditional languages. Layers and layers of history and culture and diverse religious beliefs. And while there are many unifying features in the legal culture of Indonesia, so most people speak Bahasa and many people are Muslim, and so there are unifying factors in Indonesia. There's also quite a lot of diversity. And so that makes, I think, the job of people who are developing the laws pretty very complicated. So I don't envy the government their task, because it's quite a difficult task. But I think you're right about the simplification. I know the last example I gave of the Australian Trade Practices Act was a wonderful example of how there are many different laws in commercial practice in Australia. And finally, somebody worked out that really it could all be summed up in a sentence, which was, when you engage in business, don't be misleading. If you think of, that's actually a very simple idea. And it actually is an idea that has a lot of resonance and a lot of religious reasons. So if you're going to do business, don't lie to people. I mean, it's a very simple proposition. And in Australia, there were many, many, many laws that were saying that in different ways. So they decided to simplify things by just saying it once, and it made life so easy for lawyers in Australia because it was all simplified. To say, okay, everything's about Section 52 of the Trade Practices Act. It actually made life easier for the lawyers, so I can understand why the professor has endorsed that approach, which I also endorse.
Okay. Yeah,
silakan tadi pertanyaan kedua, minta tolong Mas mikrofonnya. Oke.
Sini.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum Professor, my name is Dafran. I will undergraduate student. to make it brief, I'll try to talk with you in English. If our House of the Representatives pass the omnibus law, the omnibus law of taxation, the government will lower our tax rate, right, from 23% to 20%. This act will attract many foreign investors. I'd like to ask, what is your opinion? What will happen to our grassroots, to our general people in Indonesia? What will happen to our domestic investors if this omnibus law passes from the House of Representatives?
Thank you.
The theory of reducing taxes is that if you lower taxes on business, then there will be more investment, not just foreign investment, but domestic investment. Remembering that Indonesia has the seventh biggest economy in the world. So Indonesia is already a very big economy. There's billions and billions of dollars in its economy already. The idea is that if you lower taxes, there'll be more investment, and then those companies will be able to hire more workers. Okay? So that's the theory. The reality is a bit more complicated than that, for two reasons. One is, you do need to collect revenue. So governments need revenue to protect the environment, for social services, to protect people with disability, to support a good education system, to support a good health system, to build roads and ports and infrastructure and bridges and electricity systems that work. There are many things that government needs to do with revenue, and so you always take a risk when you lower tax rates, that you have less revenue and then you can provide less services. As I said before, the theory is that if you lower taxes, the entire economy will grow, and so even though you lower taxes, you still have more revenue to spread around. But there has to be a point at which you can lower taxes no further. That this makes sense, because government needs to have some sort of revenue. And it'll be interesting to see, and these things tend to go in cycles. So governments will lower revenue, and then they'll raise revenue, and then they'll lower revenue, and so on and so forth. So I can see the theory. They want economic growth to go up from more than 5%, they want it to rise. But I think another thing that you need to think about is the impact of business on the environment, on human rights, on good health, and all of the things that we treasure as citizens. So we want to make sure that, it's great if a business can operate and they can employ people, but if they're damaging the environment, we don't want that. So I think it's always really important in these major economic reforms for governments to make sure that they're not creating problems for themselves down the track, because often it's governments that have to deal with the problems. So there's a famous phrase used by economists where they talk about privatizing gains and socializing losses. So there's always a risk in any economic reform that you're handing profit to businesses, but the government is still placed in a position where they have to keep the environment clean, they have to make sure there's human rights, they have to make sure the hospitals are running, they have to make sure the schools are running, but they've got less revenue to do that. So it's a very difficult balance. Every country has this problem. I think, as I said in my presentation, business reform in Indonesia has been amazing in the last few years.
the size of the middle class in Indonesia is booming. You know, in 10, 15 years, there will be 50, 80, 100 million people in middle class in Indonesia. I mean, it's amazing, the economic reform. The challenge is to keep that economic reform going while making sure that other things are protected.
Silakan Ibu Ida.
Mas, kita tolong.
So she pointed out your example on the corruption problem in Australia that happened in the 60s, and that the adoption of the Omnibus law, if it's not mistaken, it's in 1992. So she thinks that it shows that time matters a lot in the making and the adoption of Omnibus law. And my question is that, what is your recommendation to solve this problem of obligation and rather to simplify this issue rather than make it more complicated or even add chaos in our system, since there are differences in the legal system as well?
So thank you for your question,
Peter.
Thank you.
The government, the president and the government of Indonesia is very determined to go with these reforms. Now that is a fact. whatever we think about the speed with which this is happening, frankly, there's probably not much that can be done about that because they are determined to go ahead. The issue about having less opportunity to be engaged in that process before the legislation has been enacted is a challenge. So the question is, well, how do you address that challenge? You know, how can we address that challenge and avoid the negatives? You know, avoid complexity and people not knowing what's going on and people not understanding how this new law fits in with the previous laws. Well, one way that could be addressed would be to say, okay, let's say the legislation is passed in April.
Yeah.
Okay, let's say it's passed in April. One thing that you could consider is pass the law in April, but it doesn't come into effect until 2021. Okay? So you can say the law passes, but it's not actually going to apply until January 1st, 2021. Now, if you take that approach, then that gives civil society and businesses and stakeholders the opportunity to say, okay, all right, now we know this legislation is coming. How is it actually going to work? You know, what systems are we going to put in place for the rest of 2020 to get ready for 2021? So if we don't have the time on this side of the legislation, maybe there is a chance for having the time on the other side of the legislation. Okay? So, you know, after it's enacted. Now, I don't know whether that is possible in civil law, but I think it probably is, that you can say that a law will not take effect until a particular date. Yeah. So that would be my solution. And that way, people can discuss the law and say, okay, we understand that the government wants to do this and it's going in this particular direction. We now have to work out how that's going to work. And at least it means when the law comes into place in 2021, people are better prepared. Now, I don't know if that's possible. The president set a 3-month timetable for the legislation. He's very keen to get on with things, and that's impressive. I mean, that's one of the reasons he got re-elected. You know, that's a popular approach. So it'll be interesting to see how that process is managed. But I think one of the ways that can be done is by setting a delay on the implementation and then preparing for that implementation. Yeah.
Jadi, Bu Yunda, dan Bapak-Ibu sekalian, yang direkomendasikan oleh Prof. Patrick adalah, misalnya di sini pemerintah sudah menentukan rancangan undang-undang ini akan segera berlaku dalam jangka waktu 3 bulan. Tapi bisa saja kita mengatur bahwa undang-undang tersebut akan baru benar-benar menimbulkan akibat hukum di misalnya di tahun 2021 tanggal 1 Januari seperti itu. Jadi masih ada jangka waktu di situ untuk penyesuaian-penyesuaian, ada waktu bagi banyak pihak untuk bisa mendiskusikan berbagai hal yang terkait dengan penerapan atau pelaksanaan dari undang-undang tersebut. Seperti itu. Dan juga ada jangka waktu untuk mengevaluasi beberapa hal seperti itu. Dan di sini kita memang bisa melihat bahwa pemerintah, khususnya isinya Presiden Jokowi di sini adalah ingin melakukan segala sesuatu itu dengan waktu yang singkat, menyederhanakan segala sesuatu akan menjadi efisien, utamanya dalam hal waktu. Dan itu bisa justru bisa menjadi salah satu hal yang membuat beliau itu terpilih kembali. Jadi kita akan melihat nanti seperti apa, dan tentu akan selalu ada kesempatan bagi kita untuk mendiskusikan hal-hal dan berbagai faktor yang mempengaruhi penerapan hukum yang baru diterapkan tersebut.
Bapak Ibu sekalian, saya menyampaikan terima kasih yang sebesar-besarnya atas kehadiran Anda semuanya, dan terima kasih atas partisipasi aktifnya. Mudah-mudahan kuliah tamu pagi hari ini menambah ilmu kita, memberikan wawasan tentang Omnibus Law, dan barangkali nanti yang mau skripsi dan mau tesis maupun disertasi barangkali bisa memiliki inspirasi dari kuliah kita pada pagi hari ini. Sangat terima kasih sekali. Dan mari kita berikan aplaus untuk Profesor dan Profesor. Saya menutup acara ini. Terima kasih. Selamat siang. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Kita tutup bersama ya di depan. Karena tadi dari pihak Humas, Pak, tutup bersama Pak. Nanti kita publish di website Fakultas Hukum.